Hi folks, Sardar here, and in this episode of Dev with Sardar, I'm going to demonstrate PyO3, a crate for the Rust language that lets you build Python extensions. Now, I'm sure we've got a lot of fans of both Rust and Python in the audience, since I cover both of those languages here. Python is convenient and fast to develop in, and Rust gives you high-performance computing with memory safety. And they complement each other nicely. PyO3 gives you a whole new way for them to do that. Now, normally, when you write an extension for the Python runtime, you use C, or at the very least, you use some language with a C-compatible ABI. Rust can provide that, and so you can write Python extensions in Rust with the right tooling. PyO3 provides that tooling, and it provides a lot of other convenience on top of that. So let's take a look at how this works. Here, I've got a directory with two projects created in it. One is for Rust and the other Python. I've already installed a Rust toolchain on this system, as you can guess, and I have a Python virtual environment here in the env directory. Now, when we want to use PyO3, what we do is we pip install into this env a build management package for PyO3 projects called Maturin. Maturin can create for us the base scaffolding for a PyO3 project, and it provides other utilities for us to make it easier to work with that project in Python. So here in the source directory, this is for our PyO3 Rust crate, we have a few functions that we've designated are going to be used on the Python side. And the way this works is twofold. First, we write a Rust function, and then we decorate it with the PyFunction macro to indicate that it can be called from Python. And then we take the functions that we've decorated like this, and we gang them together, and we expose them as a Python module by way of this function, which I've decorated with the PyModule macro. Now, the functions that I've got here are not very sophisticated. They're just demos. They're actually slightly modified versions of the demo functions that get created with this project scaffolding. For instance, the sumIsString function. This one also gets auto-created when you create a new project. And what this does is it takes in two numbers, both 64-bit integers, and it returns a string wrapped as a Python object. And one nice thing PyO3 can do for us is it can automatically map Python types to Rust types and vice versa. However, we have to be careful about how we handle this, because in this example, we need the integers that we pass in from the Python side to be convertible to a 64-bit integer for Rust. If that doesn't happen, we get a Python overflow error at runtime. So in these next two functions, I'm going to demonstrate a couple of different ways to interface with Python's byte array type. This is a type that you might use in conjunction with Rust functions to pass raw data back and forth. So in this first function, which we've called first byte, our input is a Rust type. It's a vector of U8s. And PyO3 can automatically convert byte array objects to vectors of U8s. The second function, last byte, we're specifying that this is a Python native object type, a PyByte array type. And when we do this, it gets converted inside the function to a native Rust type. So with this first function, there's more error handling on the Python side of things. With the second function, there's more error handling on the Rust side of things. So you can perform the error handling and the conversion, if any, in the domain that's best suited to whatever problem you're trying to solve. One more example, this last function we have here, from dict. This works with Python dictionaries. The signature for the function indicates that it takes in a hash map with a string key and a string value, basically the equivalent of a Python dictionary that uses strings for keys and values. And again, as long as we pass in a dictionary that has strings for keys and values, we're okay. If we pass in any other kind of dictionary with any other types, it will give us a runtime error. So again, there's another important difference here between using the Rust native types and the Python native types. When we use Rust types in these function signatures, our Python objects have to be converted to Rust at the function boundary. Now, if they're simple objects like strings or integers, that's not very expensive on a per-call basis. But for a rich object like our container, like a list or a dictionary, the whole object has to be converted, so that can be slow. With a rich object like a dictionary, we would probably want to do something like this, in this other function, which I've called fromDictNative. With that, we specify that we're taking in a PyDict object. And then we're performing operations that are native to that type. We're doing that all in Rust. And this is faster overall. Now, to compile this code, we're going to use the Maturin tool at the command line. Now, here's the best part. It doesn't just compile the code. It makes the compiled project available as a package in the virtual environment that we've already created. And we don't have to add it manually. This way, the resulting compiled code doesn't clutter up the Python project's code tree. It's tucked away in the virtual environment. So here's the Python code that we're going to use to import and invoke this Rust crate. And as with any other Python extension, we just import it and we call the functions that we've decorated by name, as we saw before. With this first function, we take in two numbers and we return a string result from some simple math that we've performed on it. And note again, that because of the function signature, these two numbers must convert to 64-bit integers. If we change one of them to be too big, like this, and we rerun the code, we're going to get a runtime error, as I demonstrated before. These other two functions pass in a Python byte array object, and they retrieve the first and last elements. And finally, we have two different ways to access a Python dictionary, one by converting it to a native Rust hash map, and the other by keeping it as a Python project and accessing it using Python native methods. And again, in either one of these cases, the access to the dictionary has to be type safe. If we try to create a dictionary that doesn't have the right types as its keys or values, or we try to access one that doesn't have the right types, we get a runtime error. So as you can see, the big advantage of using PyO3 is the integration and the tooling with Python generally. It's far less messy to create a Rust crate and use it with Python than it is to build generic C extensions for Python, thanks to Rust's modern build tooling. So if you're a Python user and you've been looking for an excuse to learn Rust and integrate it into your projects, you now have a convenient way to get into it. And that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Devith Sirdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.